Welcome to Smith Weekly Discussions, an occasional program for our readers and listeners of Smith Weekly Research. Please note this program is a private discussion and everything contained herein is for entertainment and educational purposes only. With that, we hope you're in a comfortable position, along with your favorite beverage, to enjoy the discussion. We remind our audience to examine the show notes attached to each of our shows to better understand how our program functions. Before we get into our discussion, we want to say thanks for questions coming from our audience at Smith Weekly, including Jared W., Paul M., Andy S., and Steve B. Returning to the show today is Taj Singh. Taj is president and CEO of Discovery Metals. Discovery is advancing the development stage of a large silver Cordero project in Chihuahua State, North Central Mexico. The company also has a pipeline of Mexican exploration stage projects. Discovery Metals is listed on the Toronto Venture Exchange under the symbol DSV, and also on the U.S. OTC markets under the symbol DSVMF. Taj, thanks for coming back on the show, and are you squeezing your silver tight?
Thank you very much for having us, and yeah, it's definitely been good to see some nice tailwinds in the precious sector, especially silver.
Well, Taj, let's get it off the ground here and talk the silver market status here. I think that's probably first and foremost. I'm not much of a fan of these artificial moves, but the rather organic fundamental improvement for this sector is really where I think is the importance. With that, your thoughts on the market here and your thoughts on this silver squeeze trend?
Yeah, not way too much to be said about the silver squeeze. Obviously, it was very short-lived, but I think it highlights the power of the retail investor. And if these, especially now this millennial generation, if they can get behind something, it's going. And the silver market's not that big, and it can really, really start moving if people get behind it. And then with the role of the internet and people to be able to do their own research and figuring out things about, for example, how the silver price is being manipulated, they can really start piling in. So it was nice to see, obviously short-lived, but I actually really don't prefer the really huge rips in price in silver, to be honest, nice and steady. But what it really has is brought silver to the forefront for people to realize that, listen, this is the supply and demand fundamentals of silver are highly positive over the next decade and beyond. Silver is going to be needed, really brought to the forefront. Silver's need as really the investment side, we understand. Listen, silver reacts, extreme on marginal buying and selling because the size of the market is so small in the investment demand cases. But as an industrial metal, the fact that there's growing demand for silver in the automotive sector, electric vehicles, the solar energy industry, and then now 5G and potentially even 6G networks, which are all part of just one example of the new administration in the U.S., the part of their plan. All these things are major parts of their plan for clean energy revolution. So silver plays a huge part in that. And I think just the industrial demand alone is going to drive the price, drive it up from here.
And Taj, just on the broad macro view for silver, there's a lot of different opinions out there. With some of the research that you and your team have done and what you've seen in the sector, at current prices and with the industrial demand side, I get that. And with the tailwinds on the financial side, there's certainly some demand for silver for purposes of wealth preservation and, of course, speculation. But at current prices with the production centers around the world, what is your thought on the real supply demand fundamentals at current prices? And when do you think that the market will start to see, be a little bit more forward looking in terms of what the current price is today versus the forward look for demand? What's your thoughts on that?
Yeah, it's pretty clear over the past, I think, 5 years, production supply has dropped. The global supply has dropped pretty substantially. And even a 5-10% drop in this, if it continues, it's leaving huge amounts of deficits of silver. I think that's being realized right now, again, because of the size of the market of silver being quite small in comparison to gold, for example. And listen, I think people are going to start realizing that you're going to need a higher silver price to be able to bring online a lot more of these silver projects. And, it bodes extremely well for silver. And I think that's actually starting now. I think that kind of movement and those that kind of thought process is starting now.
let's move on here. Let's talk, maybe we'll come back to the macro stuff in a moment, but let's update on Discovery here, Taj. Maybe just give us a quick overview of the current capital structure, the shares, cash, and of course, the key holders at this point.
The current shares outstanding are about 320 or so. We just a couple days ago announced warrants from 2017 that had expired. Those are 31 million or so of those. Our current cash balance is just in and about $100 million Canadian, so very, very well cashed up to really advance the project. And also have a significant portion of the equity capital, we believe, for the build. And market cap hovering now at a very decent kind of around $800 million Canadian. So we've really really been able to load up the coffers and really, I think a lot of people are getting, again, positive on silver. And the fact that we are one of the world's largest silver deposits on a mining belt and all the other characteristics that you need for something eventually becoming a mine, we have those. Cordero ticks those boxes. And those have all helped bring the share price up. In terms of ownership, as you know, our largest shareholder is Eric Sprott. He owns 27%. Been a great and supportive shareholder. Insiders, founders, management, and board own about a little over 10%. So definitely got skin in the game. Institutional ownership's about 30%, and retail's in and around 30% as well. So pretty good kind of coverage across the various groups for ownership.
And Taj, where do you and Mark stand on shares owned at this point? Maybe you can share a little bit of color on where you are. And of course, Mark, I think, is also an important component of his commitment to the silver part of this thesis and also just the company and how you guys have put this together.
Mark O'Day, the founder of Discovery Metals and the principal of Oxygen Capital, I believe, you know, he's sold very little of what he has so far, only really to cover warrant exercises, which were expiring primarily. He's almost got all everything he's had since he came in on the original financing. I believe he's in and around 6 million or a little bit more shares, and he's got obviously some options, so quite a bit of exposure, maybe close to 8 million or so kind of exposure. Myself, I haven't sold a share other than about 10,000 shares a few weeks ago to cover a warrant exercise as well, because those were expiring. I was in on the original financing. So I have all of my positions, which is close to about 2 million shares, about the same or a little bit more in terms of option exposure as well. So we're definitely got skin in the game, like I said, and we see this moving up stronger.
Taj, talk about the CapEx requirement as things stand, and I'll get into the PEA and how you guys are going to move this forward. But you guys have a CapEx now that is notably lower than where the market cap of this company is today. It's not too often that you get this type of setup. We see a lot of companies out there that have a market cap that's a fraction of their CapEx requirements. And so talk about that for a moment and what that provides you guys, the optionality to be able to take advantage of this market cap setup going forward, where there's just not a lot of scenarios out there that line up with what you guys have done.
Yeah, that's a really good point you brought up. And we really try to highlight that in our discussions with investors is the fact that, yeah, we're looking for kind of an initial CapEx around 200 to 250 mil, materially lower than the older version of the scope of the project that the previous operators had contemplated. And again, yeah, so our market cap is multiples of that, you know, and we're also one of the very, very important metrics for us is the NPV to CapEx ratio. We believe we'll be 1-to-1 NPV to CapEx ratio is considered a good project that could, you know, has high likelihood of becoming a mine. And I think we'll be well north of that, multiples of that at spot prices. So we're in a very good position because not only the size of the project, the long life of the project, there's not many out there. We're talking this thing could be 3 decades, 2 to 3 decades easy. There's not many projects out there that have that long life, that have this kind of size, the ability to stage and expand the production. And again, the simple fact that we're 5 kilometers off a major highway, there's a power line up one side of the property, you're on flat rolling ground with nothing really around you. You know, you're remote enough to be able to set up a very large kind of operation. So all of these things obviously help bring the CapEx down. And also, I still am a strong believer that Mexico, in terms of both CapEx and OpEx and just mining in general, is a top jurisdiction. All of these things contribute to the fact that this project is really in a class of its own. There's not many out there. And in terms of quantitatively showing that, you're right, NPV to CapEx ratio, market cap to CapEx ratio, we bode well on those.
You guys are at PEA update level here, And so I guess my concern is, and I'm interested to hear on how you guys plan to make this go strategically from here with the current market cap. How do you guys continue to grow the market cap here? And that I know that ties into the plans for the rest of this year. You guys haven't even put out a PFS and you've got this market cap. So how do you keep this fantastic setup going to keep the interest going, to keep the value growing to where when you guys do finance this thing and construct it, that it's a relatively easier exercise than some company who has a 50 million market cap trying to raise 200 million to build a mine?
Yeah, that's a good point. I will note that we are putting out a PEA. We're internally calling it a PEA plus. As our listeners may know, the Cordero project had a previous resource and PEA, several of them, as they continue to drill and update the resource and put out new studies. There's a lot of data. This project is already de-risked. It's not really a PEA project. I just want to make that clear. This really, the product we'll be putting out is we're really shooting it and targeting for it to be a PFS level kind of project. Both the resource, we think there's going to be much, much more in the indicated and above categories, for example, in the resource than you'd ever normally see in a PEA. So again, de-risks it. The CapEx estimate, we're really digging in there. We're trying to move it towards almost a PFS level of estimate, both OpEx and CapEx. And just the amount of drill data we have, like there's, you know, over, you know, 400 and some odd holes in this project now. The new resource coming out is going to have almost 200,000 meters of drilling in it. This really isn't an arm wave PEA. This is really, again, moving towards a PFS. And I think that's helped us. We've been able to show that we're de-risking this project. People already know what it kind of looks like. It's not a project that there's other projects out there that ended up companies that had a very high market cap, but that's even pre-resource. Here, you know what you're kind of getting. It's additionally de-risking it with more and more drilling and a team that's done it before in terms of optimizing a mine. And moving it towards the development and construction stage. Another thing to point out is the old study that's out, I think putting the new study out will really show people and provide, you know, detailed studies and analysis of really what this new project's going to look like. And I think there's quite a few investors that maybe know about it, but a lot of them don't, you know, the positive attributes this project has and really how the metrics stack up versus other projects. I don't think a lot of people actually realize having that project out there, I think will enable us to close the gap of what, you know, what we actually think our peers are trading out. And we think we're actually probably at a discount to it if you compare it to similar peers.
Yeah, that's good information. And we've got deliverables that you've stated, deliverables that will be a updated resource model and, of course, a PEA update by the end of the year. And then the metallurgy improvements are done at this point. And based on what you've said, this PFS is really just a simple exercise to move from this highly detailed and multiple updated PEA to a PFS. So my suspicion is to get to a PFS isn't a lot more effort. And then, of course, the DFS is the big cheese, of course, for the final financing and decision-making. So what is the timeline here to get to that PFS level? Can that happen next year, 2022? And are you guys comfortable just to take this attack on in at current prices?
In terms of moving to a PFS, your first question, definitely 2022 is what we're targeting. To be honest, also relating to one of your comments, is we might go right to a feasibility study. I'll be honest, depending on what we see in this project, how much of the resources in the higher confidence categories, even, but I didn't mention the previous comment I'd made, but the metallurgy exactly is going to be a PFS level of metallurgy. We're currently doing a pretty exhaustive program, looking at the entire deposit and the various domains, various lithologies, and just getting a really granular view of this thing in terms of the process engineering characteristics. If we go to a PFS 2022, second part of 2022, and we are contemplating, depending on what we see here, going potentially right to an FS.
Yeah, that sounds good. And looking forward to seeing that progress stay on track and have you guys get serious about, and I think you've been serious all along, but maybe the market doesn't realize that, but that this isn't just a wave some documents and some permits in the air and a hope that someone comes and buys you, but rather that this is a development project that we would like to see you guys take forward in the group if no one comes through with a superior offer, just to go ahead and move this forward within the group. I think you guys have proven time and time again that the group can build these projects and operate them successfully. And so I think that that's an important piece to point out. Talk about just for a moment, some of the other pipeline assets. Is there any motivation, Taj, in management to option, JV, or monetize a portion of the pipeline for the benefit of the Cordero advancement and for shareholders? And I guess, let me just tie it in with a sister company. Cal Everett over at Liberty has been able to monetize insignificant or just, you know, projects that are insignificant to Black Pine and Goldstrike. But basically just, you know, a little bit of this activities to also bolster the bank and to continue to de-risk what's going to be Cordero. What's your thoughts on pipeline and how you guys are going to go about doing that?
That's a good question. Listen, discovery is Cordero. That's it, flat and simple. We really don't think of it actually as just a project. I want to note that we think Cordero will be a district in and of itself. We think there's multiple deposits here at this property. We're on one of them. The Cordero resource area occupies less than 1,000 hectares. We have 35,000 hectares around it. We already have probably 15 to 20 targets, earlier stage targets that we want to work on. We're hoping two or three or four of them we can be built up into drill ready targets. They're definitely prospective in terms of geochemistry, geophysics. And so we've already allocated a budget of about $2 or $3 million, mainly mapping and sampling, with a kind of goal to potentially have them drill ready in fourth quarter of 2021. So we think that actually is going to provide quite a bit of exploration system, you know, whether or not they're part of the main large system, which this is such a strong system. I mean, for something to go in and mineralize 1 billion tons of rock in the middle of a property, you'd hope that there's a high probability for other deposits nearby. And we do definitely believe that there is. We haven't really worked on them because we've been so focused on the resource area and staying with the previous operator. So Cordero in and of itself, we believe, is a district. We think there's other exploration properties right on that that completely can be synergistic with Cordero. That's obvious. And the other properties you talk about are in the sister state, the nearby state of Coahuila, which were the original properties in when discovery started in late 2017. Those are ready to drill. We have about three key properties. Two of them are ready to drill. One of them, we're still waiting for some permits. You know, we're going to continue to work on that in the background. Those are very, very high grade. They're different than Cordero, extremely high grade silver, zinc, lead properties, much less tonnage, but again, very, very high grade. We think those have high potential to be something. They're much earlier stage. So again, the low hanging fruit, the most obvious way to drive values at Cordero and the surrounding Cordero area. But those projects we've kind of said we're going to look at, we're going to, you know, continue to evaluate when we want to work on them. You know, if there is a chance to do something with them, spinning them out, monetizing them, that is a possibility. But in a way, they kind of go pretty well with Cordero because they are silver, zinc, lead. They're in the same state nearby. So the actual kind of incremental cost to work on them and build them up wouldn't actually be much. So I you know, in summary, we're pretty open on it. If something, you know, we're not going to, you know, work at pushing to move these projects because really we've got $100 million in the bank. And we don't really need to bolster the cash balance. But if something comes across the table that makes sense, we would look at it. And also we'll continue to evaluate if these are worth, you know, the appropriate time is to drill these.
Yeah, that makes sense. And for an operating company that's becomes depleting and so forth, obviously a pipeline makes a lot of sense. And I know that there's good potential in these projects. And maybe you guys keep one, maybe you keep two, maybe you're able to option out with an interest. But still, I mean, if you can generate 20, 30 million or on option agreements, et cetera, monetization on maybe one or two of the projects that you see as less non-core, big stride forward for the financing as well. Notwithstanding that you have a lot of cash, but as you know, the more you can do this, the better I think the performance will happen to be. And of course, you guys are a lot of the way there already with your cash pile. And so we'd like to see this continue. On your comment earlier at Cordero, is there any, you know, just looking at the belts here and the trends, do you guys plan to expand that footprint more towards along some of these trends in terms of other side of the power line and other side of the highway there? What's your thoughts on expansion?
Yeah, we're really, the low-hanging fruit is really in and around the resource here and expanding that. That's completely what we're focused on now, for at least until this resource in PEA comes out. Longer term, we've already got, like I said, about 20 or so targets. we'll, you know, call that down to 6 or 7, and then maybe 3 or 4 of them ready to drill, maybe even more. But it's again, like I said, such a large land package. We will continue to continue to evaluate the opportunities across the property. Last year was the first time airborne mag and EM was flown over the property. That's provided a huge amount of information, new layers of information, which we're going to get to continue to use for interpretation. So yeah, it's I think that gets missed also. The resource is the resource, and it's going to be a mine, but there's high potential for other deposits nearby, and we'll continue to explore a land package to look for these.
And Taj, just one more thing here, just on that, before I want to get to social license in a moment here, but if you guys do proceed here and you get to a DFS level, at that point, are you guys at current prices, assuming silver doesn't, you know, drop out here, but at current prices, let's just assume 2 years forward here, you guys have a DFS in hand and you're ready to go. You've been able to conserve cash, and the silver price, let's just call it in the same location as it is today. Nothing happens as far as the market price improvement beyond this current price. Will you guys go ahead and pull the trigger on this and develop it out yourself?
This is another point I want to make up. Silver's ran, but I don't know if people will remember. Our goal on this project was to make a project that works at $18 silver. We have a project that works at $18 silver. That's huge. It'll be one of the largest primary silver mines in the world. That's at $18 silver. Now, the part that I think some people are getting, but maybe a lot of people aren't getting, is the fact, the ability to get that even larger if silver goes up. So most silver mines, a vast, vast majority of them are underground mines. You're either in ore or you're in waste. So if silver price goes up, you don't add ore. You have a margin expansion. There's no resource expansion. If I go from $20 to $25 at Cordero, my resource size, with no more drilling, my resource size increases by close to 500,000 ounces. Of silver equivalent, just by going from $20 to $25. If I go up further, then go to $35 an ounce, it'll increase another 300 million ounces. And that's all laid out in our cutoff grade sensitivity from the previous studies. So it gives you a good guideline of what this project looks like at higher prices. But that's really the big thing about this, is we are working on a project that works at $18 silver, that has knockout NPV to CapEx ratios, fantastic IRRs, fantastic paybacks. That full stop. If silver goes, I really don't think there's any project that's got the leverage and the torque we have, because you not only get the margin expansion, as I said, you get huge resource expansion.
What's the thought though on the development, as far as you guys will take this forward at current prices?
This project is completely showing that it could be a mine at lower silver prices. So at these silver prices, yeah, we would keep moving this ahead for sure.
Okay. And talk about just the sensitivity for just a moment, Taj. Just give the people that are listening a flavor for, if they expect the silver price to go up, let's say we see $35 silver, $40 silver, and we get back to the previous highs in silver price. Just talk briefly about how that levers discovery of metals.
Yeah, well, so I mentioned in the previous example that The very neat thing about this project is its ability to be staged and its ability to expand seamlessly. There's a core, and then around it is another ring of medium grade ore. Then there's another huge ring of lower grade ore. Then there's, so if silver goes to, you know, $40, $50, you know, like there's a resource here that's over 1 billion ounces of silver equivalent, probably more to be found. So depending on what you give silver, maybe an in-situ value, because obviously those haven't been put into a mine plan, etc. They obviously will be pit constrained if you made a huge mega giant pit, but just think about it in an in-situ value, right? So you've got 1 billion ounces, say, plus or minus 1 billion ounces silver equivalent, and silver goes up, you know, $5 an ounce from where it is now. Maybe you realize $2 of that in terms of an in-situ value increase. That's an increase of, you know, close to $2 billion. And then it goes up another $5. Maybe you don't realize the whole $5 increase, but you realize some portion of that. But it just shows you, because of the sheer size of the deposit, what this thing could really be worth. Like, silver guys are trading at typically, if they're in good jurisdictions right now, in situ value, $2-3 an ounce. Easy, probably, if you got a higher, like kind of like the silver crests and the mags, or maybe even higher, like $7-8 an ounce. So even if you put something in at $4 or $5 an ounce, just on an in-situ value basis, you can see Discovery is trading at a fraction of what it even should be now.
That's interesting, and appreciate the idea there. And definitely, you know, the in-situ value is, you know, has certainly some basis. The NPV part of this is important, but of course the NPV assumes that, you know, there's going to be cash flow at a certain period of time, et cetera. But definitely it has substantial leverage, as, you know, we've highlighted, looked at this as well, but it definitely carries quite a bit. And talk just briefly about the importance of the zinc lead component of this project as well, because this also, if zinc and lead continue to have positive pricing and even at current pricing, Taj, this is a nice big fat byproduct.
Completely. Just to tie in with your last comment before I talk about the zinc and lead, is the only reason I really talked about in situ values because we haven't really contemplated a mine plan for $40 silver. Definitely a pit could be put under there. And to be honest, almost the entire resource would be economic at that kind of silver price. That's why I only related to the in situ component. I'm, you know, we're all about NPVs and putting stuff in discounted cash flows and seeing how those line up, obviously. I only did that as kind of a thumbsuck kind of idea on where this thing could go. And then just to point out, in our PEA that we put out, we'll be putting our base case, which is a project that works at $18 silver. But we'll also be putting out in either a separate chapter, an addendum to one of the chapters, what we call a blue sky case. And that's an accelerated expansion and a bigger project for higher silver prices. So people who think silver is going a certain way can go look and see, understand the economics of that. There'll be grade, there'll be strip, it'll be all laid out there. So I just wanted to point that out. On your question of zinc and lead, yes, you know, silver at spot prices, silver represents about 60-65% of the NSR value of the deposit. Gold is about 5-6%, maybe a little more, but zinc and lead, you know, in and around about 25% of the value. And you know, listen, it's, we've been starting to look at numbers for zinc and lead. Zinc and lead supply demand fundamentals are fantastic right now. I was looking in the kind of the demand and the need for zinc is increasing all the way to 20, 40, or 50. It's more than doubling. So the zinc price fundamentals look very strong, lead as well. And again, a lot of these are used in high performance and even in some green initiatives. So it's a nice chunky byproduct, as you say. Again, you're having intervals of sometimes, depending on different parts of the deposit, 3-5% of significant widths of zinc in along that comes along with silver. So it's definitely something that definitely adds to the NPV.
Yeah, and I appreciate the clarification on that, Taj. And I wasn't going after you for the in situ stuff, but what I do go after sometimes is in specifically the silver sector. There's a lot of this talk about in situ, and these guys are never going to build a mine, but it's all about their in situ and they think where it can go type things. And I'm not saying that that's not possible, but it gets abused is what I'm saying. And
completely agree with you. Completely agree. Yeah.
Okay. Let's talk social license here. What is the status on social license status? Maybe things on the permitting side, as far as I know you guys are still a little bit early here, but you guys are coming up on, you know, environmental impact statements, et cetera. Just talk about the local community government relations and how that side of things are going.
Yeah, we've been very proactive in this. We're very far ahead considering we're only at a quote unquote PEA stage. We're already you know, very actively involved in terms of social engagement, community engagement, hiring local workforces. Those are all very much important part of our program. Environmental studies are already underway. We've already within 2021, we will start submitting permits for construction. And we are actually permitted at this point all the way to a construction decision. In terms of any of the exploration activities we need, we're completely permitted. But we're going to continue that and actually start submitting applications in the back half of this year for construction. So we're moving that along very quickly. The kind of social license, we're in a mining area through and through. It's an ex-mining district. Even on our property, there's quite a bit of, you know, direct shipping, you know, small little shafts. But generally, they have the mentality, and some of them come from families that have been involved in mining for decades, if not centuries. Mining's part of their DNA. Even the state we're in, Chihuahua State, is one of the best mining states in Mexico. We have very good relations with the state government, local government. We continue to stay active and be in touch with them. They're very supportive of the project, both at the local and state level. They know the kind of size this is and what it can mean for employment. And yeah, we'll continue to push on the social license to operate. Great point of view.
With that too, you know, obviously things are pretty good there as far as the speed and where you guys stand. And definitely if you can keep the government well on your side, we've noticed that there can be a lot of success in Mexico as long as the government's on your side. And then of course, there can be some companies who can cause trouble and also cause problems where people think Mexico is not so fun. But I think if you can do it right and you can keep the wheels greased, so to speak, I think that that really works well. Back to the financing side for a moment. With your guys' current cash, you know, some of those warrants, I don't think there's any warrants left, is there?
No, there is in 2022. There's some warrants. Those will help contribute to the balance as well, to increase the cash balance over next year. They're in the money right now, strongly. Yeah. We've got about 30 million warrants or so, average price of them, because a bunch of them are at $1.75 and some of them are at 77, I believe. So in and around kind of halfway between those two. And then the big point of those I want to note is three quarters of them are owned by our largest shareholders who want to continue to increase their exposure with the project. So they're in good hands. That's the thing to note.
Yeah, and it's likely if the share price holds up well that those could come in early. So with that, though, and where you guys have, where the market cap stands today and where it can potentially go as you guys continue to progress and deliver, is there a need for conventional debt financing at this point? And could you use, if the terms are good, could you use some type of a stream agreement with one of the royalty companies? I know you guys have thought about it and you probably even had some conversations at this point, but what's your cost of capital is really going to be? Because you guys are in a nice position right now.
Depending on what the CapEx ends up being, I think we're going to have a very significant portion of that, the equity portion of it. And I think the other portion, the classic thing to do is the remaining portion with debt. I think debt terms are fantastic, as good as they've probably ever been in terms of cost to capital. So we have started high level thinking about these kind of things. You know, when you target a kind of debt to equity ratio of 70-30, we'll probably be better than that. You know, so it's just been more high level discussions, but the fact that, you know, going back to debt side, this project is going to be completely de-risked. Additionally, it's an open pit project. A lot of times there's a little bit of from the debt providers. Underground projects need a lot more kind of, you need to be sure and safe about them. This is an open pit project. It's going to be drilled to a significant kind of, you know, very good kind of drill density that'll give confidence in getting the project financed. So at a high level, we've spoken about it. We think we're in a very favorable position again to have a majority of the equity portion of the build. And then, yeah, our general thinking right now is the other portion with debt down the road.
Any thoughts on existing shareholders, some kind of silver notes, delivery in bars, anything like that?
We've tossed around the idea, but we haven't really dug into it yet, but that's something we'll obviously consider down the road.
Okay. Taj, I promised to come back to a macro thought for a moment. Any thought on silver's connection to many financial systems out there? And if the price gets out of control or untamed, if you will, by what's happening in the market, both paper side and physical, and of course, the supply demand fundamentals that we discussed earlier, do you think that risks with silver out of control or at a much higher price, at least a multiple or two from here, do you think that risks any collapse of certain financial systems?
You know, I think it probably does. I think somehow we're going to see some stability in the price. I think it hit a high of $49 before in 2011. I think it naturally needs to go there at least. You hear people talking about $100 and much beyond $100 silver. I don't know about those. That seems potentially problematic, as you pointed out. You know, pretty strong case for it to be able to go to 50 and beyond. Those are my kind of points.
Yeah, agreed. I think we can get back to at least the last high, and the commodity cycle would point to that fact probably playing out at some point, maybe not on the time frame that everybody wants. Certainly think that that's possible. And if it relates to any other commodities and their performance, once they break out from their past highs, we've also seen that they can have a lot of runway left. So we'll see what happens. Well, let's wrap up here, Taj. Potential investors who are on the sidelines listening to our chat today, market cap stands around 850 million Canadian here. What would you say to potential investors at this stage and at current price levels?
Yeah, I'd like to say that, listen, despite what seems like a quick rise in market cap, you know, if you look at enterprise value, we've got $100 million in cash. So that contributes to the 850. There's not really any project that's got the kind of size potential we have in the silver space. Silver space is limited as it is. There's very few primary silver open pit mines in the world, and underground mines don't give you the resource expansion we see with open pit mines. We're on a mining belt. This will be a mine. Lots of surrounding infrastructure. Lots of ability to make this project larger and larger and larger as CapEx is paid off as silver price increases. We've de-risked this project. We will continue to de-risk it. We've already de-risked it quite a bit. We will continue to de-risk it. And it's a team that's done it before several times. You know, despite, again, the market cap increase, as I pointed out previous points in the discussion, we think we're trading at a pretty significant discount to what we should be trading at. And I think as we get moved closer towards the study, and eventually as the study comes out, it'll be clear, you know, what the real value of this project does. And then on top of that, if silver tailwinds continue to be favorable, again, the kind of leverage and torque we have, you don't see it out there in the space.
Best way for investors to reach out to you and the company?
Yeah, you can connect through us through our website, www.dsvmetals.com. We also have a Twitter page and LinkedIn. They can also connect to us through that. Yeah, we're readily available to communicate with investors as needed. We're pretty active as well in social media, I want to note. Try to do at least 1 to 2 interviews a week. It's been great to be able to get the message out there. So we'll continue to do that. In terms of news coming out every 3-4 weeks, expect a press release. In terms of drill results, metallurgy results coming in the second quarter. And just because the resource is coming out and the PEA is coming out, it doesn't mean we're stopping the drilling. I just want that to be known, that we're going to continue drilling throughout the year, seamlessly moving to PFS drilling. And so continually expect news from the company every month or even less.
Taj, you're a busy guy. Keep up the efforts there. And you guys definitely are not in a position where you have to talk much about what you're doing. You just have to deliver on the ground, which is what you guys are doing. And we can see that in the share price, irrespective of any awareness activities that you guys are working on, including coming on our show. But we definitely appreciate you taking the time with us. It's been a great chat. Keep up the work, and looking forward to having you come back again soon.
That's fantastic. Always great to be here. Thanks.